Yes, thank you. I believe we are all born explorers, you, me, and everybody else. For a long time, I used to travel in one particular direction in my search for happiness. I sailed across the Atlantic, from Africa to Caribbean, through the Panama Canal to Galapagos, Robinson Crusoe Islands, down to Chile, through the Strait of Magellan, through the Falkland Islands, all the way down to Antarctica, and back again around Cape Horn. And after that, I started to think about traveling to the ends of the Earth, skiing to the North Pole, South Pole, and soon after, I decided to, with two friends, Børge Avsland and Geir Randi, to ski due north. We're dragging about 120 kilos each, and the temperature went down to minus 54, and we were attacked by a polar bear, and as you can see here, I'm standing here with a Magnum 44, so it's kind of, come on Teddy, make my day. However, unfortunately, it eventually charged, and we had to kill it. However, shortly afterwards, I decided to travel in the opposite direction, due south. So I skied for 50 days and nights without any radio contact until I actually reached the South Pole itself. And then when I got to the pole, I had already decided to become the first to the North Pole, South Pole, and the third pole, Mount Everest herself. And it's hard going up there. It's easy to get frostbites. But however, I made it to the top. And I promise you, you're not spending much time at the summit of Everest before you start to wonder how in hell to get down again. However, for me to explore is a love affair. It's totally absurd and also totally engulfing. And after all this, I worked for some years, kept on traveling, and then I decided to travel the opposite direction of everybody else. My vision kind of narrowed. I didn't want to go outward, but down, down, down to where nobody is traveling. And I want to do something akin to what Dante did. I'd read Dante, the Divine Comedy. And when he was halfway in life, just like I was at the time, he decided to travel. He asked himself some very, very uncomfortable questions, and he decided to go down into hell. And I didn't have a hell to go to, so I decided to walk underground through the subconsciousness somehow of New York, through its mythical sewage system, train system, metro system, and water tunnels. And we started up in Bronx and walked under Bronx into Manhattan, through Manhattan and into Queens and Brooklyn, all the way out into the Atlantic Ocean. So it was kind of an expedition of personal contemporary archaeology. And I want to see the city I love, New York, from 180 degrees up, kind of upside down. And I also wanted to see myself, Erling Kagge, a very privileged man with a great girlfriend and three beautiful daughters that I love, and see me in a new perspective, because I was wondering and wondering, why don't I feel better when I have it so good? Can it be that everyone else who have thought that about happiness and can it be that I and everyone else who have thought about happiness and unhappiness as opposites have been mistaken? I believe so. And I was wondering, what has happened to happiness ever since Aristotle, Buddha, and the Stoics explained how one can become happy, and up to the discovery of Prozac and the invention of the happiness industry? I'm not sure. But however, I went to a psychiatrist, I went to a priest, I read books on well-being, but and I have great respect for many people in the happiness field, but somehow, for me, to dig into this material was like watching you porn on the net. It was well done, but it really didn't get me any closer to my goal. for happiness, the happiness industry is somehow founded on the capitalist basic principle of repurchase. A product must never be perfect. It must disappoint to keep the turnover up. But as old chaps knew 2,000 years ago, happiness is an activity and there is no hocus-pocus formula available. So Steve Duncan, as we can see here, my companion in New York on this underworld journey, a great man and well-seasoned urban explorer, and I planned the expedition together. We want to sleep on the ground, surface every day to swap tunnels, and in our backpacks we had all the gear needed for this mini expedition. At occasions we were joined by others, Jackie Lydon, Andrew Wonder, Will Hunt, Brent Mullen, and Alan Foyer. It was some snow in the day, at the day we started December last year. We knew that even a tiny rapid current can make walking very, very difficult. And still more melted snow can mean that we lose our footing and can be swept down through the tunnel with no hope of control. And of course, there's also the possibility of poisonous gases and also the risk of being caught by the police. But of course, obviously, this is not very legal. But however, I thought about Dante again, and as he told himself on his way through hell, our length away urges to haste. After the first long night in Bronx, down towards Harlem, walking along the sewers, we took a break at Dunkin' Donuts up above the sewers. We celebrated with some hot chocolate. The service was discreet. This was 5 o'clock in the morning. They all wear this kind of identical hats and identical t-shirts. And here's my friend Steve, relaxing with a donut with shit in his face from the sewer. It struck me while sipping to my hot chocolate that far too often during the past 40 years, I have found myself thinking about what is just about to happen, dreaming myself away, wanting to move on instead of enjoying life in the here and now. Restlessness has taken civilization forward, yes, but it can also have a pathetic side. Paradise is where I am, a philosopher once wrote, I think it was Voltaire, but unfortunately it's rarely that simple. It's more like Woody Allen once said, when I'm in New York, I'm dreaming about being in Paris, and when I'm in Paris, I'm dreaming about being in New York. And I remember as a kid, I read about Amundsen, the first man to the South Pole 100 years ago. His first thought when he reached the pole itself was, I never ever in my life been further away from a goal, because his childhood dream was to become the first to the North Pole. Between Manhattan and Brooklyn, we climbed to the top of Williamsburg Bridge. From there, high above East River, Manhattan looks like a long chain of mountains. To the southwest, I could see the empty space where the twin towers of World Trade Center once soared, where the high wire artist, Philippe Petit, you know, from the movie High Wire, spent 40 minutes balancing, smiling on a thin wire stretched between the twin towers. When he eventually was arrested by police, he was asked if he resisted arrest, but Petit replied very intelligently that he did not, but rather stated, I resist death. I can recognize myself in that utterance. It is a question of giving oneself the freedom to pursue a dream, or grasping at something outside yourself. The choices I make are my own while I'm on an expedition, and I'm alone, and I alone am responsible for them. So there is no one else who can be blamed. Life then or there is what means something. When Børge and I were attacked by a polar bear, the only question was who's going to have who for dinner. The past didn't matter, the future didn't matter. So, being on our way is the opposite of dying. While philosophers write about existentialism, life on an expedition is existentialism in practice. Underground, somewhere around 100th Street in Manhattan, we celebrate the 50th birthday of Brooklyn. A lady called Brooklyn, a friend of Steve's and a friend of mine, she has lived there since 1982, and Her home is not very accessible. It's a 4 meters climb up to the top of the tunnel, where she has a little terrace and a fairly nice space, as you can see in the background in the photo. But when talking to her, it always strikes me that she appears to be so happy, confident about life. So I asked her how that could be, and she replied, "It's called appreciate what you got and hold on to it. I don't lose it. I don't know why people are miserable. They got everything I don't have, and I'm happier than them. I believe you have to treasure what you got." In some way or the other, she has seen through the business concept that underlies the enormous growth of popular psychology. We people are never satisfied. Instead, she has found her own path. Moderate your desires, want what you have, and you'll have what you want. Meanwhile, above ground, we may, as Brooklyn indicated, be living in the first society where people are actually unhappy about not being happy. In addition, Miss Brooklyn embodies the teachings of the Stoics in regard of accepting the realities of life, plus a touch of Buddha and the third of his four noble truths: to eliminate suffering, eliminate craving. Maybe I was too drunk and naive for life in a tunnel that night. At least I was very, very pissed after the birthday. Or perhaps I was right when I thought that Miss Brooklyn, in spite of everything, has a deeper insight into human nature than most people up in the civilization. A kind of complete reversal of Plato's allegory of the cave. Above ground, people live in an illusion, while reality is found down in the tunnel. After that night, in the company of Brooklyn, I was looking forward to returning to the sewers. Not because the sewers are wonderful, but happiness can also consist of dirt, bad air, and being in a stuffy tunnel. I am not thinking of my own and other people's experiences that happy moments presupposes that you know the alternative. To appreciate warmth, you must know what it is like to freeze. I know everything about that. Montaigne, the French essayist, wrote about the joy of finally being able to pee when he had kidney stones. And the Greek philosopher Epicurus claim that pleasure is the only true good and pain the only true evil. Times though, according to Epicurus, it is a good idea to seek negative experiences to be able to attain positive events later. The one follows the other. Montaigne and Epicurus are of course right. But while walking through shit and family paper and avoiding to being caught by the NYPD, I start to become aware of something else. Happiness and well-being, as it's often understood, is pretty overrated. One of the reasons I love skiing to the North Pole, study law and philosophy, being an entrepreneur or looking forward to get into a sewer pipe, is that what produces a feeling of happiness and what is nasty or repulsive are interconnected, can occur at the same time and do not have to be consecutive. Well-being has a faithless cousin called discomfort, and the combination of the two is experienced as happiness. If you are wondering if I believe it is necessary to seek out unique situations in order to achieve happiness, the answer is no. Moments of great happiness in everyday life are often reflected in it being a damn hard slog, and as the old saying goes, life is hard and working in an office makes it even worse. However, when I notice now, when I get a bit older, I mostly remember or recall the good times. On the fourth night through New York, when navigating through the sewers under Soho in Lower Manhattan, where they use much more toilet paper than they do up in Bronx and out in Queens, I saw a brown rat, the common Verrattus norvegicus. He was standing about a meter away from where I was crawling ahead, a bit up on the edge. We were looking at each other. Our heads were about at the same height, and I gazed into two inquisitive eyes. I wondered what it was thinking. At any rate, it must, assuming it could think that far, have seen my life in the tunnel as being totally meaningless. If it had been possible, I would have explained very slowly my friend Arne Næss, the philosopher's formula for happiness. As you can see, happiness is ardour, can be raised to any number you want, and bodily pain and spiritual pain. As I said, we are all born explorers, you, me, and everyone else. That is what drives us forward during the first years of our life. Following my three daughters growing up, I've seen all of them climb on stairs, staircases, and steep slopes before learning to walk. Once they learned to walk, they stopped climbing. The natural state during the first years of one's life is to wonder what's behind the next hills and to want to have more space around yourself. An explorer is not something we become, it's something we are. Happiness and curiosity are present from day one, but something that then decreases. Our civilization is a good idea, obviously, but I believe it is a good idea to reclaim some of this natural inheritance. On the fifth day and the last evening, I mentioned to Steve a sentence by Montaigne in his last essay, which I particularly like. Life should be an aim unto itself and purpose unto itself. Aim and purpose. Both of us liked the sound of it, and we walked a bit in peace. And then Steve asked me what I thought Montaigne could have meant by that. And I only had a vague inkling. But question what you are told. There is nothing new under the sun. Be present in the now. Do not underestimate your own possibilities. Appreciate what you have. Read and see much. Remember that you will die, but do not be afraid of your own death. Accept that the meaning of life is the meanings in life. The world is not what it first appears to be. The world is as you are. And go on a trip to the underground of New York, start to the north, and don't stop before you're up to your waist in salt water. Steve looked up thoughtfully. It sounded like our own towel under Manhattan, or the future of happiness. Well, nobody knows that future, of course, but the reason I came here today was to say that it is worth suffering a bit, pushing the envelope, and Adam, the world's first explorer and role model, was not expelled from paradise. He left because he was curious, he wanted to get laid, and he see the world and feel the world. And finally, I would like to recommend everyone to find your own path and to reach your own North Poles. Thank you.